услышит тот, кто уже пришел. Мы не будем откладывать начало выступления, потому что связь с профессором Мороско уже здесь, и ровно в 9:30 он выйдет на связь с нами онлайн-трансляция. Поэтому просим спикера первого, это... Сейчас, секунду. Ласло Тордей. Да. Проблема...
Доклад, посвященный нейроэндокринным опухолям, диагностика и современные методы лечения. Dear Laslo, we welcome you.
Can you begin? Yeah.
Can I start the presentation? Okay, so it's a very great honor to me to be invited and present this type of topic here in Kiev. I didn't have time to look around because I just arrived yesterday night, but the only thing what I know that people are just wonderful here, and thank you very much to be invited. So I'm a medical oncologist working for a university in Hungary, and I'm treating lots of neuroendocrine tumor patients. And my talk will be about the diagnosis of neuroendocrine tumors and about modern treatment options which has been emerged. And I'm trying to focus on new developments presented in the 2015 ESCO meeting. Okay, but I need some help because this is not.
Подойдите, пожалуйста, техники.
Okay. So, why the neuroendocrine tumors? Okay, thank you very much. Are really interesting group of malignancies because it arises from the neuron system of the body. It can emerge from many sites in the body, and it could be functioning or not functioning, and it's very hard to diagnose it because it can arise from everywhere. If we investigating the frequency of the neuroendocrine tumors, we can divide different kind of origins. Most of neuroendocrine tumors are arising from the pancreas. The name of that is pancreatic nets. It could be functioning and non-functioning tumors. Functioning tumors are releasing different kind of hormones, which depends of the origin of the neuroendocrine tumors. So it could be a gastrinoma, insulinoma, glucagonoma, VIPoma, somatostatinoma, and pancreatic polypeptidoma. And it is also could arise from different other part of the body, especially from the gut system. So foregut neuroendocrine tumors could be emerged from the lungs, the stomach, the duodenum, and midgut net tumors could arise from jejunum, ileum, appendiceal. They having appendiceal origin, and the midgut tumors included the right colon and the transverse colon. The hindgut neuroendocrine tumors are arising from the left colon side, the sigmoid, the descending colon, the sigmoid colon, and the rectum. And there are a couple of additional sites like the ovary, the medulla, adrenal medulla, and paraganglia. The classification is quite mixed. Different kind of staging systems are existing, the WHO staging, the NS staging, and the AJCC staging. Why why it is really interesting, the neuroendocrine tumor for an oncologist? Because the number of the neuroendocrine tumor is just increasing, and according to the latest data, this increase is very, very significant. So if we are investigating that which kind of neuroendocrine tumors are increasing, almost every type of neuroendocrine tumor shows the increase in frequency. So it seems to be that so the question is that why the numbers are increasing, and lots of people suggested that probably the diagnostic procedures became a little bit advanced recently, but it seems to be that every kind of neuroendocrine tumor frequency is increasing, like the pancreatic NETs number, which are less than 2 centimeter, increased by 710% over the last 22 years. But if you are investigating parallelly the number of pancreatic NET tumors which are bigger than 2 centimeters, you can see that the number of these tumors are also increasing, so not the diagnosis is responsible for the increasing of the of the numbers. And if you are investigating what is the connection between the increased incidence of neuroendocrine tumor and mortality, you will also see that the mortality trends are similar to the incidence trend, that meaning that not just the diagnosis is better and not just the diagnosis is earlier. So when the mortality and the incidence are increasing together, it means that this became a little bit more frequent tumor. What are the incidence by side? It seems to be that the foregut neuroendocrine tumors are the most abundant, and after that, the midgut tumors are the next one, and the hindgut tumors are closing the row. It means that basically, the pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor are the most frequent, together with the neuroendocrine tumors arising from the stomach, and approximately 15% of neuroendocrine tumors are also coming from the pulmonary system, especially from the bronchi. What are the challenges of the treatment of neuroendocrine tumor? I was talking about the rising incidence, and these diseases are very variable diseases, and it has a broad spectrum from the benign time to malignant time, and it also shows different grades and activity. And there are lots of unmet medical needs in the treatment of neuroendocrine tumors. First, the 5 years overall survival rate has not changed in the last 20 years of age due to the lack of specific treatment options. We have only limited options to treat patients having advanced disease, I mean unresectable or metastatic disease, and we really need some kind of improvement in overall survival and quality of life of these patients. Basically, this is not completely true what I said about the changing in the last 20 years treatment. If you see these pictures coming from European databases, you can immediately realize that recently the survival curves are just improving, so we are making minor steps to treat this kind of malignancies. How the 5 years survival rates are varying from different parts of the world? It seems to be that Northern Europe and Ontario are leading this race. The 5 year survival rate is around 60% in Western Europe, and in the Eastern Europe are showing a little bit worse results. In Western Europe, the 5 year survival rate is somewhere around 50%, and especially in Eastern Europe, it's about 40%. Needless to say that it reflects the quality of the United Kingdom healthcare system, that right here, the 5 year survival rate is also somewhere around 40%. We really don't know why why these numbers are in that range. Probably the Eastern European population will be diagnosed a little bit later, and probably they don't have the access for all of the modern treatment. What are the prognostic factors of the neuroendocrine tumor? There are lots of them: the age, the sex, the race, the site of the tumor, the Ki-67, the differentiation, the stage of the disease, the possibility of curative resection, a socio-economic status of the patient, the country and the region, and in the next part of my presentation, I will focus on a couple of very important prognostic factors. Basically, the survival depends on the tumor sites. So it seems to be that appendiceal tumors showing the best 5-year survival rates, thyroid cancers, rectal and small intestine tumors are following this, and probably the pancreatic and stomach and head and neck nets having the worst prognosis from the neuroendocrine tumor. Which is really important is the grade and the stage of the tumor. It seems to be that the stage one is just only the T1 tumor. The stage two tumors are not having lymph node metastasis. If the tumor is T4, which means that the tumor is unresectable, is staged as a 3A. And if the tumor has an N1, it has an N1 status, which means that the tumor is node positive, the stage is 3B. Any tumor which has metastatic lesion considered to be the stage 4. And as a clinical oncologist, I have to basically focus on the stage 3 and stage 4 diseases. It is also very important to note that if we are talking about the grades, what does it mean? Grade 1 tumor means that the mitotic number is less than 2 and Ki-67 index is less than 2. Grade 2 tumors are considered to be tumors which are showing the Ki-67 index between 3 and 20, and grade 3 tumors which are a little bit more undifferentiated and expressing more Ki-67. The Ki-67, one of the basic markers. If we are investigating how the grade will give us information about the possible survival curves, here is the Kaplan-Meier survival curves of 926 neoplasms from the European Neuroendocrine Tumor Society, and it seems to be that grade 1 tumors showing the best survival outcome, and grade 3 tumors showing much worse outcome. So it's also very important for the patient to detect the grade of the tumor, because if we know the grading, we can say lots of things about the survival to the patients. And this is also proof of this coming from the publication of the working group of Yao, and it seems to be that if the histology is well differentiated, this means an advance in contrast to the poorly differentiated histology. What is the terminology? The terminology also reflects the differentiation and grading stage of the neuroendocrine cancers. So the neuroendocrine tumor is, which are having the grade 1 and grade 2 features. Neuroendocrine carcinoma is showing a grade 3 differentiation stages. And every other cancer is not considered to be a pure neuroendocrine tumor. We start to talk about the diagnosis. So this is a very, very complex algorithm for the diagnostic procedures. If a patient approaching us showing the sign of the flush, which is one of the marked symptoms of the carcinoid syndrome, and I don't want to talk about this. My message with this picture is that if the patient approaching us with the flush, we have to consider it having a carcinoid syndrome, and we have to do everything to detect a neuroendocrine carcinoma behind the sign of the flush. So even for example, this woman is just changing the menopausal status, we have to focus on these diagnostic procedures. I was asked to talk something about what can we do with patients presenting with liver metastasis, because it seems to be that probably lots of possibilities has been overutilized. The first step what we have to do when we are detecting liver metastasis is to characterize the liver metastasis with imaging methodology. The first step could be the ultrasonography, but after that we have to have any the information with the CT scans or MRI scans. So without a proper CT scans, without a proper MRI scan, so without a proper imaging, we are not able to define the treatment of the patients, and we are not able to follow the behavior of liver metastasis, and we are not able to follow the effect of our treatment. When the liver metastasis has been diagnosed and characterized by the proper imaging, we have to do everything to identify the primary, where from these liver metastases are coming. So, because liver metastases are arising basically mostly from the gastrointestinal tract tumors, as a first step, we have to perform a gastroscopy and a colonoscopy of the patients, and probably we could include endosonography to investigate the state of the pancreas. Sometimes CT scans and MRI are just not giving enough information about the tumors of the pancreas, so the endoesophageal ultrasonography could give us lots of information about tumors located in the pancreatic head. And we also can use the previously utilized imaging to find the primary. So sometimes you can find the gastric cancer or colorectal cancer in the CT scans. But if you have problems with this, you can also utilize PET scans to detect when the primary is. You also have to screen different kind of gastrointestinal malignancy tumor markers like CEA, CA1990, and CA724. But if you don't find the primary tumor, you have to get some kind of specimen from this liver metastasis. So you should perform a guided biopsy from one of the hepatic lesions for histology. And histology will show the origin of this tumor, except rare cases of anaplastic carcinoma. And if the histology is net, you have to ask the pathologist to provide a very vital information regarding the grade and the Ki-67 status. And sympatophysin and chromogranin staining is also very, very useful. Here are some diagnostic procedures from NET. You can see that abdominal pelvic CT and MRI is also mandatory. The somatostatin scintigraphy to detect distant metastasis, which cannot be seen on CT scans, are also a must. And the diagnostic procedures are varying depending from the localization of the primary tumor. So if the tumor is functioning, biochemical evaluation is needed. And if the tumor can be seen by ultrasonography like duodenal or pancreatic NETs, you have to do that. And in case of gastric neuroendocrine tumor, you have to perform the B12 level evaluation. And in some cases, the chest CT is also indicated. What are the elements of biochemical evaluation? It depends from the type of the tumor. If the tumor is a carcinoid tumor, you have to perform the chromogranin and 5-HIAA investigations. If the tumor is pancreatic NET, you have to look after different kind of hormones like calcitonin, pancreatic polypeptide, and insulin, WIP, glucagon, and gastrin levels. What are the systemic treatment of this neuroendocrine tumor? So if the tumor is resectable, your first step has to be to resect the tumor. You have to try to achieve an R0 or R1 resection, and I'm talking about the resection of the tumor, including the metastasis. So it means that if the patient having hepatic metastasis and you identify the primary tumor, you don't have to resect the primary tumor if you are not able to remove the metastasis, just in case of other indication like this tumor is rising from the ileum and it try to obstruct the ileum, so you have to provide a passage of the bowels. So if you can achieve the resection, you have to follow up the patient, and in case of metastasis, you have to start a specific treatment for the neuroendocrine tumor. Basically, we have to divide two types of neuroendocrine tumor, the functioning tumor and the non-functioning tumor. If the tumor is functioning, you have to try to suppress the function of the tumors, I mean anti-hormonal treatment and symptomatic treatment, like you can perform the cytoreductive surgery to ease the symptoms, just to decrease the number of hormonal releasing cells, and you also can use PPIs and different kind of other drugs like diazoxide to suppress the function of these tumors. If the tumor is non-functioning or progressing, there are lots of other treatment options depending on the grade, which can be used. You can use interferon, different kind of somatostatin analogs, everolimus, temozolomide, sunitinib, and different kind of chemotherapies. The basis of the chemotherapy was the carboplatin and adiposit combination, and right now the PRRT, which means that the protein receptor radiotherapy is also available in Switzerland. So fortunately, the Hungarian national reimbursement system are supporting the treatment of the patients right here. So here is the three principles of the treatment of the NET. The first is the surgical treatment, because I'm not a surgeon, I'm not able to provide detailed information about that. But you have to try to perform a curative surgery. Debulking is indicated when the bulk of the tumor induces symptoms, and this is indicated for the treatment and prevention of different kind of complications arising from the tumor load. The second principle is that the symptomatic treatment, which means that the control of hormonal syndromes. And the third principle is the anti-proliferative treatment, which means the control of tumorous growth, and probably it could lead to the better survival. How can we use the symptomatic treatment? We can use biotherapy for the symptomatic treatment of the NETs, and the backbone of this biotherapy is the somatostatin analogs and the interferon alpha. Why we are using the somatostatin analogs? Because somatostatin receptors are expressed by most of the NETs. Pancreatic NETs and midgut NETs are expressing all of the five types of different kind of somatostatin receptors, and somatostatin receptor 1 and 2 and 5 is responsible for the hormone secretion, and somatostatin receptor 1, 2, and 3 are responsible for the proliferation, and SSTR 2 and 3 is responsible for the induction of the apoptosis. How these somatostatin analogs look like? So you can see the structure of the native somatostatin and the structure of octreotide and the lanreotide, and these are the two somatostatin analogs which are available on the market right now. The receptor binding affinities of these somatostatin analogs are very high. They are acting very specifically on somatostatin receptor 2 and a little bit showing slightly less affinity towards somatostatin receptor 5. So if we are going back a little bit, here you can see that they can inhibit the hormonal secretion of these neuroendocrine tumor cells. What was the evolution of somatostatin analogs in the last couple of years? So here you can see that octreotide has been synthesized at 1982. And it was approved for the treatment of the symptoms of carcinoid syndrome at 1984. The LARET, it has been developed and approved for the treatment of carcinoid syndrome at 1996. I'm talking about treatment of symptoms, not the treatment of tumor. And at 2000, it has been reported that octreotide can inhibit tumor growth. And at 2014, we also got some information that lanreotide also can inhibit tumor growth. Now we will investigate this kind of question. So now the somatostatin analogs are used to basically treat the carcinoid syndrome, and it also can be used for the treatment of the symptoms generated by insulinoma and gastrinoma and VPOMA or glucagonoma, just by suppressing the hormone release of these tumors. So the condition of the patients could be improved really nice. But sporadic reports has been emerged, and we accumulated lots of experience with the usage of somatostatin analogs. And it seems to be, and couple of data came out from lanreotide and octreotide using patients, that symptomatic response, which means the control of symptoms, also associated with some kind of tumor syndrome response, which means that probably there is some kind of anti-proliferative effect of somatostatin analogs. So the three principles a little bit just changed, because even we are controlling the symptoms of the patients, it doesn't mean that we could improve the survival of the patients, and this is our main oncological task, to improve the survival functions like progression-free survival or overall survival. And because of the lack of really effective anti-proliferative treatment, it seems to be that the three principles changed, and a fourth principle has been arrived, and this is called observation. So these tumors, especially the grade 1 and grade 2 tumors, are growing very, not growing very rapidly. So the progression is very slow, and probably it means that probably they don't need any kind of treatment. So it means that if the symptomatic treatment is appropriate, we can just observe the patient. And if you are considering the fact which has been presented in my last slide, probably somatostatin analogs also can exert anti-proliferative effect, which means that probably the observation also means some kind of anti-proliferative effects. Why the anti-proliferative effects of somatostatin analogs has been kept in mind? Because according to preclinical experiences, somatostatin analogs also can exert direct anti-proliferative effects and indirect anti-proliferative effects by inhibition of cell cycle, inhibition of growth factors, and pro-apoptotic effects. And the first proof of the concept study was the so-called PROMIT study, which is a placebo-controlled double-blind randomized study. They investigated the effect of octreotide, LAR, on control of growth of advanced midgut NETs. Which is very interesting here is the patient population. This is an advanced midgut NETs. 85 newly diagnosed therapy-naive patient has been randomized. They had locally irresectable or metastatic tumors. All of the tumors was well differentiated, which means that the Ki-67 proliferation marker was under 2%, and they received 30 milligram octreotide LAR intramuscularly in every 4 weeks. The result was very, very impressive. The octreotide LAR prolonged the progression-free survival of these patients from the median of 6 months to the median of 14 months, which is approximately 2.5. The progression-free survival was increased by 2.5 times, and we learned that the octreotide LAR showed anti-tumor activity on midgut NETs for grade 1 tumors, and the patient had quite a low hepatic tumor load. It was under 10% for every patient who has been randomized. What are the limits of this study?
I'm so sorry that we should move into the end because we have to start live surgery from Barcelona.
I see.
If you excuse me, then maybe two slides and then we have to bring to end.
Okay. So
thank you.
The next study is the CLARINET study, and I will close my presentation right here. The CLARINET study has been done by the Lanreotid Autogel. The result was also the same which has been shown in the octreotide. The basic advance with the Lanreotid usage is the wider patient population. They used it in gastroenteropancreatic NETs with a little bit advanced stages with a higher hepatic tumor load, with a little bit more undifferentiated tumors. So grade 2 tumors were also included into these investigations. And this CLARINET study had also a label extension in which they used it for progressing patient. And this basically changed the whole landscape of the treatment of the NET. Now we have two studies, the PROMID and the CLARINET study for the treatment of NET tumors, and this observation changed to anti-proliferative treatment term, and NCCN guidelines also incorporated the SSA treatment into the treatment of NET tumors if they are asymptomatic, they have low tumor burden, and they are showing stable disease. And these are the good news that SSI received marketing authorization for the treatment as an anti-proliferative agent of neuroendocrine tumor to improve the progression-free survival of the patients. Food and Drug Administration in the United States accepted the lanreotide for the treatment of patient on unresectable well or moderately differentiated, locally advanced, and metastatic gastroenteropancreatic neuroendocrine tumor to improve the overall survival. And in Hungary and in Ukraine, this approval of lanreotide is just imminent, which means that we can use it for the treatment of this patient. And this was my closing slide, that from that time medical oncologists have a tool by which significant progression-free survival advance can be given to proper group of NET patients with the conservation of quality of life, considering the fact that the toxicity profile of SSRs are close to placebo. And I believe that the best option to treat this patient is probably the lanreotide, because it could give us a little bit more wide patient population to treat. My other slides are about everolimus and sunitinib and PPRT treatment, but these are not as important than these slides was, because these was the completely new information about the NET tumors. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Please excuse us for this interruption. And we could ask the question after the session.